Thank you all very, very much for coming this evening to this program on the Golden Age Shtetl and the lecture by Yohanan Petrovsky-Shtern. I have known Yohanan for many years, had the privilege of publishing him at Yale Press when I was there, and I remember well when we were considering his first book, a conversation that I had with another professor who described him to me as one of those Russian geniuses who seem to collect PhDs wherever they go. His first PhD was in Kiev on the subject of Spanish literature, and his second PhD is in Jewish history from Brandeis. He is one of those Jewish geniuses, and his work consistently breaks through boundaries, breaks through conventional ways of thinking. And this, to me, is the great importance of this particular book. I consider the Golden Age Shtetl required reading for anyone interested in the history of East European Jewish life as a whole. It opens up an era of life that has been either suppressed or memory of it destroyed or has been found to be an inconvenient fact in the grand narrative that had been constructed by many of the immigrants to this country after the war. It is a narrative difficult to construct because the documents are hard to get at, and there is a long story about how Yohanan did get these documents that formed the basis of this book, and I'm glad to say that he also used the YIVO archives in doing so. It is a book that required monumental archival zitzfleisch, digging, conniving, scheming, and in the end, he has put together a book that I think will allow many of us to appreciate, and I know that this is hyperbolic and a metaphor for which I will be roundly criticized at some point, but that there were many aspects of Jewish life over a long period of time that were not that different from the kind of life that we have on the Upper West Side, where there were Jews in all areas of life. They would sell you drugs, fix your shoes, carry the water, build buildings, teach your children. They intermarried. It was a normal life. And the great achievement, it seems to me, of this book is that it helps us understand that Jewish life in Eastern Europe was for a long period of time and for a great number of people, a normal way of life. Professor Shtern is Crown Family Professor of Jewish Studies at Northwestern University, the recipient of multiple grants and awards, including a Northwestern University Distinguished Teaching Award. He has been appointed Fulbright Specialist on East Europe, a fellow at the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute, and visiting professor at the Free Ukrainian University in Munich, and has been awarded a Doctor Honoris Causa degree by the National University of Kiev Mohyla Academy in Ukraine. Petrovsky-Shtern has published 5 books on East European Jewish history and is currently co-authoring a documentary about the history of the Jews in the early modern world, and the Golden Age Shtetl will be available for purchase at the end of the lecture outside this room. Thank you very much, Yohanan.
Thank you very much, Jonathan. Thanks, everybody, for coming. I see many young faces here, and as I look at you folks, I think do these young people know the word shtetl? And I'm really rejoicing that you seem to really know what it is all about. So I'll just cover some points to revive it in your memory, appealing to what you already know. I would like to thank the organizers of this lecture, Jonathan Brandt to begin with, wonderful team that Jonathan has at the YIVO Institute. And I would encourage everybody who is here to do whatever you can to support the Institute, because it's going from strength to strength. And I do think that whatever we can do as rank and file, ordinary people, academics, non-academics, if we can help Jonathan to build this Institute as a palace of Jewish culture, as the depository of knowledge available for you folks, we should do exactly that. This story, hold on a second, I just wanted to make sure that it is this story, right, okay. This story starts with a hunt for primary sources. That hunt brought me to the dungeons of previously classified archives, where a wealth of documents from the shtetls have lain dormant for more than 100 years. To get hold of these documents, I disguised myself as a Ukrainian clerk, a Soviet speleologist, and a polar explorer. This unorthodox approach yielded thousands of sources that uncover the shtetl in its years of glory. Until now, nobody has been able, I think, to tell the story of the shtetl Jewish tavern keepers, international smugglers, members of Slavic gangs, traders in colonial commodities, disloyal husbands, and avid readers of books on ethics and Jewish mysticism, ordinary Jews in extraordinary circumstances. When I'm talking about the sources, I mean this. Just take a look at what kind of sources are available in different archives that I worked at. This is, for example, a very interesting file about the persecutions by the Russian administration of the famous Rabbi Israel of Ruzhin. His name, Friedman, appears at the bottom of the document. This is a typical passport of one of many Jewish international merchants who were crossing the border between Brody and Lemberg, that is to say, what today is Brody and Lviv. The document outlines how this guy looked like. So I can look at it and actually reconstruct the outlooks, the anthropological aspects of Jews who lived back then in the 1810s, as if I'm reading their FBI file. And this document is also, you can also appreciate, I believe, what is the condition of the documents I'm usually working. What this picture doesn't convey is the smell of the documents. Mold, humidity is emanating, oozing from these documents. This is a document written by Pavel Pestel, one of the leading Russian members of the Decembrist uprising in 1825. He is in 1815 in Ukraine, in one of the shtetlach, and he is walking through the shtetl looking at different opportunities for housing, and he says, thank God they have Jewish houses in this particular shtetl, because if they do not have Jewish houses, we have nowhere to put the officers up. The soldiers would live in the nearby villages. The officers have to stay in Jewish houses. I'm looking at how he describes Jewish houses that we really look at with disgust, thinking, oh, a shtetl house, what is good there? But he, the Russian officer of a noble rank, is really complimenting Jewish houses, saying that they are much more convenient than non-Jewish houses in the shtetl. To understand the shtetl, we need to understand the Russian clerks who put shtetls on the map of the Russian Empire. In the late 18th century, once Russia partitioned Poland between 1772 and 1795 and absorbed million East European Jews, these clerks traveled Russia's newly acquired lands. The clerks, who never had seen a shtetl, suddenly needed to compile inventories of hundreds of shtetls for the Russian authorities. The clerks, who never had seen a shtetl, suddenly needed to compile inventories of hundreds of shtetls for the Russian authorities. At the time, the shtetls were private towns that belonged to Polish magnates, land-owning Polish nobility, who lived in the palaces like this one in Szepetowka. Jewish commerce drove the economics of these private towns, whose inhabitants were Christians and Jews, who, after the partitions, reported to both the magnates and the Russian authorities. This is one of the novelties that I am bringing to the discussion of the shtetl. I'm discussing the shtetl when it has what I would call a triangle of power: Jewish economy, administrative power of the Polish magnate, who controls everything what is in the shtetl. But we should also remember that the shtetl now stands on the Russian land. So we have Russian geography and Russian administration, which is also present in the shtetl. Jews, Poles, and Russians. Within this triangle, I am working. And it is at this triangle that I'm looking when I discuss the Golden Age shtetl. Of course, before 1772, you have Jews and Poles in the same towns. After the 1850s, you have Jews and Russians. But for the time being, between the 1770s and the 1850s, you have Poles, Jews, and Russians competing for the same kind of the control of the economy, money, and trade in the shtetl. What the itinerant Russian clerks found astonished them. Vigorous, flourishing market towns at the crossroads of trading routes. The clerks admired the industrious Jews in the shtetls, and the Jews became loyal to Mother Russia and enthusiastic about the new regime, as strange as it may seem, especially today. This was a moment of great promise for the Eastern European Jews, who hoped that Russia would provide them with a system of justice and would protect them from the arbitrariness of the magnates' governance. For some time, Russia did precisely that. And while it did, the shtetl enjoyed its golden age. The shtetl prospered because Jews, its key merchants, traded widely, bringing commodities from France, Austria, Prussia, the Ottoman Empire, and even India. Generally, Russia was comfortable with this international trade. But in the 1790s, trading with France became a problem. Russian czars didn't want to feed the French Revolution by purchasing French commodities. So Russia outlawed French goods, turning thousands of Jewish merchants into smugglers overnight. These are Jewish smugglers, how they look like, okay? And just to come back, this is the territory that I'm describing in the book: Kiev, Volhynia, and Podolia provinces, three central provinces of what would be called the Pale of Jewish Settlement, that are in the very center of my narrative. And of course, I'm claiming that these three provinces are very much representative of the whole of the Pale of Jewish Settlement. Again, stepping back for a second, when we discuss the shtetl as the Jewish village in the middle of nowhere, where nothing happens but pogroms, and I look at pictures like this, and I have hundreds of pictures like this, I ask myself a question: what kind of people living in this village where nothing happens by pogroms would be able to build this robust, wonderful, beautiful synagogue? You know where it is? It's not Lemberg, it's not Brody, it's not Berdichev, it's not Kiev. It is the town called Starokonstantinov. How many people, raise your hands in the room, have heard about this town? Okay. Starokonstantinov, Konstantin Yashan in Hebrew, as the community described its name on the Pincus. It's really a vibrant trading town with quite a bunch of wealthy Jews who contributed to the Jewish cause, and they could build this great synagogue there. And again, you have this kind of synagogues in many towns. I believe that if we look at these Jews down as non-entities who could hardly, trade in shmatis, in the marketplace, I'm sorry for the word marketplace, we cannot explain how they would be able to build that beauty. I just mentioned Russia that doesn't want to allow international trade connect between France and the central parts of the Pale of Settlement. So this is the boundary that was created through the new established customs, and Catherine the Great did her best to make sure that all these international merchants that were connecting Paris to Leipzig, to Brody, to Lemberg, would never be able to bring their commodities to the central part of the Pale of Settlement, and she formidably failed. Smuggling, a highly lucrative and risky business, involved Jews and Slavs of all denominations in supplying the shtetls with imported goods. The lure and usefulness of the contraband gave the smugglers a positive image among Eastern Europeans. Jews became heroes who successfully were challenging the Russian drastic trading restrictions and giving people the goods they sought. Whatever the state laws created in St. Petersburg, local town dwellers, Russian clerks, Ukrainian peasants, Polish noblemen, Armenian merchants knew that, driven by Jews, contraband provided indispensable commodities. Also, it also created bonds between people of different ethnicities, more interested in a shared sense of commodity and fashion value rather than in religious differences. Take a look again at this lady. Whatever she has, by the way, this is a typical garment of a Jewish lady of a middle class in Galicia, Volhynia, Podolia, Kiev province in the mid-18th century. In the mid-19th century. What is amazing is whatever she has on her is smuggled. Lace, you call it laces, right? It's from Holland. Corduroy, it's from France. This velvet is from Prussia. These pearls are from Austria. So all of that, in order to have this particular lady dressing in these wonderful garments, everything has to be smuggled. And you have quite a number of ladies there, right? Of course, the contraband moved through the border to the marketplace, the nerve center of the shtetl. If you picture the shtetl as a kerosene store on a muddy street of a godforsaken town, you will find a walk through the bazaars and annual fairs of the shtetl an eye-opener. The Jews of the shtetl transformed the marketplace into a supermarket, filling it with goods for any taste, for people from every walk of life, from the gentry to the artisans and peasants. Once you are at the shtetl marketplace, you can taste herring and pickles, grudgingly pay marketplace dues to the communal funds, pet pigs, goats, and cows, sip wines, feel the quality of muslin and other fabrics, bargain over prices, argue about weights and measures, and see theatrical performances and even the circus. The shtetl lives through its golden age for as long as Russia leaves Jewish trade alone. But Russia, of course, is not ready to tolerate free competition in its western borderlands for too long. Take a look at the picture, please. This is what the Russian clerics in the late 18th century found practically in every shtetl, on every shtetl marketplace, and they called it by using the word of that particular time. The word is arkady, arcade, one store after another, the stores rubbing shoulders with one another in the central part of the marketplace. This is the marketplace in the town of Slavuta, or Slavita, central place of one of the most important Jewish printing presses in the late 18th, early 19th century. Here on the marketplace, day, which is annual fair, you will see hundreds and hundreds of wagons, like, for example, you see on that picture, okay? But what is amazing is that all these stores that you do not see anymore in any particular shtetl today, all these stores were in the very center, and these are permanent trading stores, like a permanent supermarket in the central part of the marketplace. All these stores were either leased by Jews from the magnate, the owner of the town, in this particular case, Prince Sanguszko, or they were owned by Jews, and Jews just bought pieces of land that they were, according to the legal arrangement, not allowed to buy, but they would purchase these tiny chunks of land to build these arcades in the central part of the shtetl. In the shtetl, something we have to keep in mind, not only the merchants, people who were in trade by business, were in trade by business. Everybody in the shtetl, to this or that extent, was linked to the to trade and traded in the market. This is a document that any of us, whoever we are, an artisans, we can be artisans, we can be tavern keepers, we can be rank and file shtetl dwellers, but if we want to trade at the marketplace, we have to pay 50 kopecks to the Russian treasury, and we get this piece of paper, blank, with a stamp saying that we actually paid this 50 kopecks. You can get a goat for 50 kopecks, just for you to understand. So it's not an unsubstantial sum of money. Then you go with this piece of paper to the local umbrella organization of the Jewish community known as the Kahal. And they have to say what is written here. Anachnu, Alofei, Dekihlateinu, Po Vasilkov, and so on and so forth. And they say, we are giving you, the person who comes to get this particular permission, his name appears out there at the bottom of the picture. What does it say? Itzhak Heikel Herman. He is allowed to go in for, and then they write in this very strange language that I'll read for you. Meshchanske torhovle. What is, excuse me, meshchanske torhovle, and in which language is it? It is, of course, Russian or twisted Russian semi-Ukrainian. Meshchanske means that the person belongs to urban dwellers. He is just the townsfolk. He belongs to the townsfolk. So meshchanske means he is a meshchanin, a legal urban dweller in town. Torhovle, the second word, means a trade. So he is allowed to engage in a regular town trade because he paid this particular sum of money. He got a permission from the Russian administration, and he doesn't owe any kind of outstanding debts to the local Jewish organization. So you have two powers that are allowing you to go and trade in the marketplace at your leisure. And it has also the signatures of Kahalny, of the head of the administration, local Jewish town administration. Of course, once buyer and seller cut a deal in the marketplace of the shtetl, they had for a place to seal their deal. Readers, those who are interested in getting my book and reading it, will join these people in drive-in taverns, pubs, and road, forest, and village inns, all of which mainly Jews ran. In the Slavic imagination, the Jew was a quintessential innkeeper, cunning but ready with low prices on high-quality vodka. This is a typical tavern, which is called a drive-in tavern, in the late 18th, early 19th century shtetl. Why is it called drive-in? Because if you are going from Starokonstantinov to Berdichev and you need to stay at an inn, you can, and there is a pouring rain like today in New York, and you do not want your goods to be damaged by the rain, you can drive into through these doors, through these gates, and you unload and unpack your commodities out there. And then you go here, here you have a room where you drink and eat, or you go to this room to stay there with your family, whoever is following you on your business trip. Remember the images of the Jews in Gogol, Shevchenko, and Mickiewicz. They were yunkels, the innkeepers. The Jewish tavern was a multi-purpose shtetl institution where Poles, Russians, Ukrainians, and Jews did their deals, arranged marriages, heard and discussed news, listened to music, played billiards and cards, and also smoked, drank, ate, and danced. Since liquor trade revenues yielded between 65 and 95% of the shtetl's income, both the Russian administration and Polish nobility did their best to control and tax liquor. When Russian regime tried to control liquor trade, it allowed the monopolist excise tax collectors to introduce fixed and quite high prices on vodka. The shtetl rebelled. Welcome vodka wars. For the ordinary Jews of the shtetl, outwitting the monopolists and the regime became a quest for freedom. Jews enjoyed that freedom until Russia stopped the Jews from producing and selling liquor and ruined one of the shtetl's key industries. Drunkenness skyrocketed once prices skyrocketed and the number of available inns diminished. If the Jews controlled the marketplace and were economically robust, they were physically robust too, as this picture made in the 1890s in Galicia shows. The shtetl's economy brought together Polish gentry, Ukrainian peasants, and Russian policemen, for most of whom verbal and physical violence was a standard form of communication, I would say everyday communication. To survive, the Jews accepted this violence as a workaday reality and learned to use it themselves. Those who are familiar with anti-Jewish pogroms may get a shock when you see Jews spitting at, cursing, kicking, beating, fighting, and plotting against one another. The shtetl, it's very much, I would not say, Jonathan, it's Upper West Side, it's rather Lower East Side, right? I don't want to put down anybody here, right? And the Lower East Side is gone, so we can think about it as a bygone era. The shtetl's violence was equal opportunity violence. Christians used it with Jews, Jews used it with the Russian authorities and Christian neighbors, directing it against anybody who challenged them in their capacity as shtetl merchants. That is, I believe, one of the important contributions that I am making into the study of violence. We think about the shtetlach or about central Ukraine as a territory where violence, especially mass violence against Jews, is something that is attested almost, you know, every 10 years. However, if you look at what is really going on there, well, we have the Haidamak Rebellion, which is the 1760s. Then you have relatively mild pogroms with very few casualties in the 1880s. But between the 1760s and the 1880s, excuse me, 120 years, you have absolutely zero cases of mass violence against Jews. And we have to think seriously about that. Why? What is going on there? Why is it happening? It is not what we are accustomed to read in the books about this particular territory. So I am trying to explain this using this terminology, using this know-how of equal opportunity violence that doesn't belong to anybody. It is not Christian. Violence is not Christian. Violence is not Jewish. You can use it. It is out there. This as we can think about violence as a pattern of behavior, as a mode of conduct. Anybody can use it. It is so. It doesn't belong to anybody. Of course, when there is trade and competition, there is crime. The shtetl was no exception. What kind of crimes did the Jews in the shtetl commit? What did criminals steal and why? By the way, they loved to steal these particular copper vessels, very nice ones, on the roster of the items and commodities that Jewish thieves were stealing. Money is number one, horses number two, textile number four, and five is these copper utensils. What do their spoils tell us about the hierarchy of values in the shtetl? Since there were many Jews in trade, there were many Jewish criminals, but Jewish convicts were underrepresented behind bars. Most accusations against Jews alleged petty robbery, horse theft, undocumented identities, assaults against Polish magnates, and vagrancy. Murderers were exceptional among the Jews, while counterfeiters were not. Jews even became East European Robin Hoods, who formed their own gangs or joined the gangs of the Ukrainian rebels. This is one of them, Ustim Karmanyuk. He had 300 Jews who were networking for him, his activities in the central Ukraine. This guy was three times arrested, and three times he ran away from the Russian authorities, being already brought to Siberia. He made his way from Siberia about 8,500 miles on foot, okay? He spoke Yiddish fluently. He grew up among Jews in Litin district. And it's no surprise that he was surrounded by Jews who were reselling the goods he was stealing from the nobility. Jews even became East European Robin Hoods, who formed their own gangs and joined the gangs of the Ukrainian rebels and plundered the gentry estates, the governmental financial offices, the houses of the rich and of all religious denominations, and, of course, taverns. Traveling through that criminal underworld of the shtetl, you will discover that Jews joined the gangs, counterfeiting enterprises the same way, and counterfeiting enterprises the same way they joined conventional commerce, with their entire families participating. Of course, the marketplace shaped not only the Jews, what Jews did outside of their homes, but also what they did inside. Take procreation, one of the highest Jewish values. Marriage was a must in the shtetl, which sanctified sex within marriage and treated unmarried male and female Jews with suspicion. Unmarried woman, suspiciously, you know, turning her back on us. Religious aversion led to physical violence in the shtetl against adulterers and other extramarital sex seekers. Since Jews in the shtetl outlawed sex out of wedlock, they opted for an immediate remarriage in case of divorce. At the same time, trade between shtetls required a high level of mobility, and that mobility led to adultery, promiscuity, divorces, and abandoned wives chasing husbands for bills of divorce. Trade brought together family members into joint ventures, and various crafts and trades shaped different family patterns. This is, of course, is a wedding ring. I would say it's a regular wedding ring. It is, of course, not something that a poor Jew would give his wife or would give his bride, but it is a wedding ring that you would very often see in the mid-rank Jewish families, among artisans, tavern keepers, and, of course, merchants. It has also a very important inscription around there from, I believe, the Book of Ruth that says, "May your house be like the house of parrots." Right, the house that brings forth many children. Trade brought together family members into joint ventures, and various crafts and trades shaped different family patterns. Real Jewish families looked very different from the schmaltz-coated families of Jewish literature and popular art. I believe I should have mentioned that I'm trying to do in the book this picture of the schmaltz-free shtetl. These families could quarrel, sue one another, divorce, but they built their families around a matriarchal principle. Men rule outside, women inside the house. But here too, the market did its trick. The wealthier the family, the more related families would live under one roof. Innkeepers, merchants, financial elite members had 3-4 families living together. Artisans lived alone. But let's enter the shtetl house. Shtetls usually sat between the village and the town marketplace, and Jews built their houses to accommodate both animal husbandry and urban trade. The demands of trade in the shtetl shaped the location, style, and size of the Jewish house. That house was architecturally unusual. A multifunctional structure that simultaneously needed to serve not only as a residence and a place to store groceries, grain, and liquor, but also a shop, an inn, a prayer house, and even a stall for cattle. Tevye the milkman of legend was not exceptional as a householder with a cow. Almost every family in the shtetl was a tevye, and almost every one of those families ran some kind of shop out of its dwelling. In the book, I'm trying to walk you through these shops and through trading stalls of wealthy Jewish merchants, the huts of widows, the attic of contrabandists, cellars of tavern keepers. I believe this is of interest not only from the historical and cultural viewpoint, but also from the anthropological point of view. Take a look at this shtetl house. We see it from behind. The market street is out there on that side. They have a gallery here and there. Big windows. You can momentarily differ the Jewish house and say, this is a Jewish house, this is not a Ukrainian hut. Ukrainian hut would have a small window. Jewish house would have a big window because they traded through windows and used windowsills as counters. Why they have galleries, also a very typical something for a Jewish house, which survived centuries. This is the market street with these galleries 100 years later. So when you are buying from the Jewish house, and Jewish house serves not only a dwelling place but also a store, and there is a mist or a rain or a fog, you will be staying in line, and everybody stays in line in East Europe, right? You'll be staying under this gallery. So this gallery allows you to stay dry while you are doing your purchases. All these shtetl houses had all sorts of addenda and corrigenda, as they say in the editorial business. Oh, all sorts of family dance, things attached to the house that they were using as stores, as storages. These are not toilets. These are also some shelters for the goats or geese or other type of animals. The families would stay out there on the second floor. The first floor would be either stores or a tavern. The shtetl in its heyday saw its value as a religious locale as second only to Jerusalem. Hold on a second. Let me make a change. The shtetl was, first and foremost, in cultural sense, a center of a book market, a new, huge book market, because more than 20 Jewish printing presses operated in the shtetls in the second half of the 18th century and first quarter of the 19th century. 10 times more than before the 1790s and 10 times more than after the 1840s. The shtetl-based Jewish printing presses became the centers for editors, publishers of major Hasidic books, major Hasidic works, works on Kabbalah, because the Hasidic masters sought to bridge the gap between traditional Jewish learning and the more esoteric study of Jewish mysticism. This is, by the way, one of the typical books published in Ostroha, which is the town of Ostrog, very important center of printing press, not only in not only for the Jews but also for Ukrainians and Russians, and it is Sefer Shnei Luchot HaBrit, the book of two tablets of law, by Isai Horovitz, one of the absolute top books on the Kabbalistic ethics. This book is bringing together the ethics of everyday Jewish life, celebration of the holidays, everyday Jewish rituals, making sense of them through the prism of Lurianic Kabbalah. But the Russian regime, with its agenda of Russian enlightenment firmly in hand, imposed rigid censorship on Jewish books, outlawing the Hasidic printing presses and confiscating books on Kabbalah, such as this. Readers who opened the book and will start looking through the inventories of the books that I'm bringing there to discuss what actually Jews read, will have an opportunity to look at the bookshelves of the synagogue and prayer house, of the homes of the rabbinic scholar, the watchmaker and innkeeper, the carpenter and the cantor. What did these people read? How much did they read? What did the Russian? Why did the Russians kill these free presses of the shtetl and finished ended up abruptly the cultural period of the Shtetl Golden Age. I am asking these questions, and my answers also have something to do with the Shtetl marketplace, with the Shtetl trade, with the robust economy of these market towns in the central part of the Pale of Settlement. This is, what you see right now, is the booklet or the brochure that practically everybody read in the Shtetl. If you ask me, Yohanan, what is the circulation of Shnei Luchot Abrit or any book by Hasidic masters, Kedushat Levi, Noam Elimelech, you name them, I would say 300 to 700 copies circulation. What is the circulation of this booklet? 10,000, published four times a year. What is this book? It is Luach. It is a calendar. If I tell you that this is a calendar, that doesn't tell too much. I need to explain what this calendar is all about. These calendars were published practically by every of the 20 Jewish printing presses operating in the Pale of Settlement between the 1780s and 1836. And we need to open, this is, by the way, is the one published in Vilna and Hrodna, it is Luach, that is to say, the calendar for the year 1830, 1831. Let's open it. This is how it looks like. Also is not very telling, but let me tell you, this is a book that really tells me a lot, and I'm sharing with you this knowledge. On the right-hand side, here and here, all the readings of weekly Torah portions. You can open this book, and wherever you are moving from town to town, you are not with your family, you are not with your rabbi, you are not at the synagogue, you will know what is the Torah portion read that particular Shabbat. You will also know what are the haftarot, the additional readings that are also listed here. You will have all the information about Jewish holidays, when they start, when they end, what are the readings on these Jewish holidays. Let's imagine that you forgot that on Purim you read Megillat Esther. The right column of this calendar will tell you. So if you are a rightist, you are Jewish. But there are also leftists here. And on the left-hand side, you have all the Christian holidays that you need to know about. Why so? Because it is on Christian holidays that all the marketplace, all the market days are appointed. It is on Christian holidays that major bazaars are happening. Annual fairs fall on Christian holidays, never on Jewish holidays. And Russian and Polish authorities are trying to do their best that no annual fair would ever fall on a Jewish holiday. Because if it does, you'll have 95% of trading people in the marketplace not there. Okay? But you know what? People tell us Jews know nothing about Christianity, Jews know nothing about Goyim, Jews know nothing about these people who live out there. They know perfectly well what is going on in this non-Jewish world. Why so? Because when you read these left sides of the calendar, you'll find amazing things there. Let me just read to you what is there.
So you know that this is Christmas. Thomas Bishop, St. Thomas Aquinas, the day dedicated to the memory of St. Thomas Aquinas, which is celebrated in Christian church. Leipzig, Danzig, and other market days. So these people who get that, they will move there, they will know that there are market days. Agnieszka, Jadwiga. St. Anthony. So all these holidays are there, and you need to know what are these days because you would like to go to the places where they have market days on these days and trade there.
Moreover, some of these holidays are amazingly non-Jewish. As for example, if you turn that page, I do not have this picture, but it lists Shimon HaKadosh, which means Saint Simon. And this is not any Saint Simon. This is Simon of Trent.
the boy who was allegedly murdered by Jews to use his blood, of course, to bake matzah, as everybody knows. Yeah, that's what Jews do, right? So, and they know about this kind of holidays because they need to know about the annual fairs that fall on these holidays. So this is what practically every trading Jew in the shtetl has in hand or in the pockets or on a table. Yes, that's a wow. That's exactly the sense that you have to have when you enter a synagogue. This is just a regular Ukrainian synagogue in the late 18th century. The shtetl in its heyday saw its value as a religious locale as second only to Jerusalem, and even as a Jerusalem. During ritual services, Holy Land artistic images transported Jews to the Temple of Jerusalem. Tzaddikim, leaders of the Hasidim, newly emerging communities of religious enthusiasts, capitalized on this imagery and presented themselves as the high priests and their courts as the shtetl's version of Jerusalem Temple. The Rebbe's dinner table, Tish in Yiddish, became the temple's altar. But Jerusalem was more than a metaphor. Almost a century before Zionism became a political movement, Jews of the shtetl welcomed communal envoys from the Holy Land, listened in awe to the visitors' sermons, and raised funds for the Jews in Palestine. The Russian regime, at war with the Ottomans, who then controlled the Holy Land, considered this Jewish religious yearning for the Holy Land an act of disloyalty and tried to disrupt financial and religious links between the Jews in the Russian Empire and the Jews in the Holy Land. Of course, the more aggressive the Russian got in their attempts, the more aware the Jews became that their shtetl was no Jerusalem. But it took time. And perhaps for a good century, late 18th, early 19th century, Jews were using all sorts of imagery and artifacts in the synagogue and also at home that was reminiscent of the land of Israel. They were claiming, they were thinking about themselves as people who live in a sort of Jerusalem in exile. Look at this spice box used to separate Shabbat from other days of the week. This is what they call besamim. You look at it, you do not see anything special, but there is something special. All those deers. Why do you have these deers? Because there is a metaphor in the Bible, Eretz Tzvi, the land of the deer. So when you are holding this spice box and separating Shabbat from the rest of the week, you are actually holding Eretz Tzvi in your hand, the land of the deer. I can explain how this metaphor works, but it's very important that for the Jew, the end of Shabbat and the image of Jerusalem, the image of the Holy Land, are interconnected. Of course, the Golden Age shtetl contributed enormously to the creation of these imageries. This is, of course, Keter Torah, something which is placed on the Torah scroll when the Torah scroll is put in the Holy Ark. And look what is in the center of this Keter Torah. Of course, these are images of Jerusalem. This is Migdal David, and these are other artifacts that are reminiscent of different aspects of the Holy Land. So as long as the shtetl has its golden age, it is absolutely confident that it is a Jerusalem of Ukraine. But of course, there is an end to this period. Thank you. I will be more than happy to answer your questions, but please let me remind you, I'm a bad guy. I do not take statements. I take questions. Okay? Thank you. Go ahead, please.
One second.
The beginning and the end of what you're calling the Golden Age. Are you saying 1760 to
18? I'm starting the Golden Age of the shtetl with the partitions of Poland, when Russian administration comes in and when Jews look at Russia as at a new opportunity for themselves to establish themselves firmly in that particular land. let me put it this way, 1770s for some territories, of course 1790s for others, but between 1770 and 1790, you cannot really say that the Golden Age starts on March the 19th, 2014, right? So I allow myself this kind of a fuzzy period, but I would say 1770s, 1780s. And until the 1840s, when Nicholas brings aid administration into the towns, when the Russian administration manages to kick out the Polish rulers, the Polish magnates from these territories. Also, it doesn't take place momentarily. In some places, it is immediately after the Polish rebellion of the 1831. In other places, it happens only in the 1860s. But again, this period of time for different shtetlach is the slow end of their golden age. I would say 1850 or early 1860s is the time when I would say shtetl enters the period of its wooden age, of its decline. Go ahead, please. Right. The question is, can we compare the Golden Age shtetl to what happens to Jews in early modern Poland? Well, King Kazimierz and King Bolesław Chorobry cannot be called early modern. Well, of course, the question is how we define early modernity. I define early modernity. I start early modernity in 1451. I can give you a long spiel why I do that. But both Kazimierz the Great and Bolesław Chorobry, kings who issued charters, or what we call privileges, to the Jews, they are 200 years before that period of time, or 150 years before that period of time. So my point is this. The Polish kings who invited the Jews to settle, they invited the Jews to settle in the crown towns, not in the shtetls. Jews move from the crown towns to the would-be shtetls only as they are squeezed from or they are pushed out the crown towns. To give you one example, when Jews are banished from the central part of Krakow, from the walled city of Krakow in 1414, 1415, they move first to Kazimierz, and then many of them move to eastern Poland, to Ostrów, to Berdychew, to other towns. So this is only then when Szlachta, when the Polish nobility, starts inviting Jews to settle in private towns. The shtetl that I describe in the book is a private Polish town on the Russian land, managed economically by Jews. That this is something very interesting that you see only at that period of time and only at that part of the land. So Jews who are in crown Polish towns in the 13th, 14th, 15th century, as little as we know about them, they are better compared to, let's say, Jews in Frankfurt, Jews in Hamburg, Jews in Venice, and later to Jews in Amsterdam. But they are, of course, no match to the Jews in the shtetlach. I believe I'm answering your question. Go ahead, please. The question is, all these Jews who settled in the United States, what part of Russia they came from, and whether the Pale of Settlement persisted, until what time? The Pale of Settlement is a word combination that emerged among the administrators of Nicholas I, perhaps in the 1810s, 1820s, but as an institution, as a territory ruled, governed by the Russian administration, where Jews are allowed to live, that this 15 Western provinces of the Russian Empire, this territory emerges with the first, second, and third Polish partitions, so 1772, 1793, 1795. And what is amazing is that before 1772, there are no Jews legally living in the Russian Empire. So we can say whatever we want to say about the Pale of Settlement, but the creation of it is a formidable feat for the Russian authorities, who for the first time say, yes, Jews are allowed legally to reside on our territory. Excuse me, 1 million Jews. So that is a huge number. So the Pale of Settlement is initiated as a form of legal presence of Jews in the Russian Empire, which had not tolerated Jews before. Now, the Pale of Settlement is legally dismantled in February, during the February Revolution of 1917. But certain groups of Jews are allowed to move outside of the Pale of Settlement. There are many books of that. I would very much recommend the book by my colleague, Benjamin Nathan's, which is called Beyond the Pale, where he discusses Jews in Moscow and St. Petersburg who are allowed to live outside the Pale. In my book, Jews in the Russian Army, I discuss Jews who moved with the Russian Army outside the Pale of Settlement and created clusters of Jewish presence and also the communities, long-lasting communities in Irkutsk, Tobolsk, Tomsk, Kazan, St. Petersburg, Moscow, Tiflis, and so on and so forth. So there are earlier attempts to dismantle the Pale of Settlement conducted by different Russian ministries and institutions. Now, where are Jews who are now in the United States coming from? Well, perhaps I would need two semesters of lectures with two lectures per week, three response papers, a midterm, and a final paper for me to be able to explain to you and to teach to you what are the approaches to the answers to this question, but not the answer to this question. Go ahead, please. Yes, yes, you. Ma'am, I'm sorry. I pointed to this man in the second row from the end. Yeah, go ahead, please. The person addresses me with a question, tongue in cheek, asking whether the picture that I'm describing is closer to Pobedonosov, who is the advisor of Alexander III, and also the spiritual father of Nicholas II, of the Russian Tsars, who is the head of the Russian Synod, the umbrella organization of the Russian Orthodox Church, and the mastermind of Russian ultra-conservative politics in the late 19th century. The person who asked me the question also says maybe my picture is closer to Solzhenitsyn, who wrote his ignominious or ignominious, I never knew how to pronounce this word correctly in English, called 200 лет вместе, 200 years together, to which I wrote a scathing review a couple of years ago. The answer to your question is no. No, I don't think that my picture is closer to these guys than to Sholem Aleichem. My picture is very close to the grassroots reality that I'm reconstructing. I'm not trying to please Sholem Aleichem, believe me. I'm not trying to please Solzhenitsyn. I'm Yohanan Petrovsky-Shtern. I need to please myself, and I need to do the work that I'm doing. Thank you. The question is about Polish magnates. Who are they? Are they just rich people? Polish magnates are phenomenally, formidably rich. If we talk about those people who are owning the shtetlach in the area that I'm describing, Ganski, Branitsky, Czartoryski, Potocki, Sapiega, Radzivill, these are enormously rich people. These people who have 10, 15, 20, 40 shtetlach. That is to say, towns. In addition, they have hundreds of villages. These are not only the Polish szlachta, that is to say, Polish nobility. Poles have 10% of nobility in their country, five times more than any other country in Europe. This is not just szlachta. These are magnates, that is to say, the land-owning nobility and the top of land-owning nobility. These people are very important because, let me remind you, Poland from the 16th century elects its king. And if you are Sapiega, Radzivill, Czartoryski, you might have very good chances to be elected a new king of Poland because the kings are elected from these noble families, right? So you are part of the very top hierarchy of the state, financially and politically. I believe I'm answering your question. There is a very good book about that written by Moshe Rossman, actually from Chicago, one of my spiritual mentors. The book is called The Lord's Jews, Lord's DS apostrophe Jews. It's more on economic part of this history, but it's perhaps one of the two most solid, one of the three most solid books ever written Polish Jewry on the 18th century period. Go ahead, please. Good question. Was the church Roman Catholic or Eastern Orthodox, and what was its role? I'm discussing in the book this image of the Russian Orthodox, Eastern Orthodox, Pravoslavnaya Church on the one hand and the Catholic Church on the other hand, who are, in our imagination, with their sword high in hand,
persecuting the Jews and trying to convert them to either Catholicism or to Eastern Orthodoxy. This is bullshit. You know, Jews are so strong in the shtetl, they are not afraid of anybody. Church plays really very little role in any kind of economic pursuits. The church can hardly compete. The church, especially Catholic Church, in its monasteries has big barrels with wine, and many monks are engaged in wine brewing. Now, the point is that they cannot compete with the Jews. They can produce wine for local magnate or for the monastery needs, but they cannot compete with Jewish tavern keeping and liquor trade, right? So economically, the church is really non-entity in that particular period. Politically, culturally, well, we do see how Jews behave vis-a-vis Catholic priests and vis-a-vis Russian Orthodox priests. I tell quite a number of very funny stories taken directly from the court cases when Jews, for example, in Umань, alleged two priests from a local Eastern Orthodox church of stealing something from Bet Midrash, from a local house of study, and they actually apprehended these two priests, put them almost in chains, you know, tied them with a rope, and took them throughout the city, exposing them to public disgrace. And the Russian police did nothing, because they were sure that Jews have a sense of justice, and what they do is just, you know, amazing stories. They are really perpendicular to our line of reasoning, and they are mind-blowing when you start reading these stories. So I would say the church is there. When you see any kind of a shtetl, you do see the Catholic monastery, like in Berdichev, or the Eastern Orthodox Church, like in Slavuta, on the horizon, on the skyline of the shtetl. It's funny to think about the skyline of the shtetl, but yes, it has a skyline, like New York. But the role of these institutions in the shtetl life is very minimal. Wonderful questions. The first question is about the documents that contain some data and statistics on the shtetlach. I have hundreds of these documents, maybe thousands. The second question is, I'm using the word shtetl for demographically very different areas. Is it what I'm doing, or is it something that other people did too? No, this is, let me start with the second question. Yes, this is what I am doing. And I'm trying to say that the shtetl is a concept, is a cultural concept, which we misrepresent or misread. I define shtetl as a private Polish town with an economy driven by Jews and run by Russian administration. So I have this triangle in the definition of the shtetl. Now, I'm also saying, and please feel free to read through chapter 2 when I'm discussing statistics and demography, again, trying not to impose all this data on you, but just selecting through it and making sure that I'm telling a story, not only, you know, producing tables. Of course, I'm trying to say that the shtetl demographically is not Jewish. The shtetl, any shtetl, at the period of time that I'm describing, has between 40 to 65% of Jewish population, and, excuse me, between 60 and 40% of non-Jewish population. Poles, Ukrainians, Russians, Polish administration, Russian urban dwellers, Ukrainian peasants who had been already freed before the 1861 liberation of peasants. There were Ukrainian peasants already belonging to the state living in the towns. What makes the shtetl is not the amount of Jews. You might have 15% of Jews in the shtetl, but it'll be a shtetl. You might have 40,000 people in the shtetl, like Berdichev, but it'll be a shtetl. What makes the shtetl into a shtetl is what Jews do economically in it. If the town has Jewish, if the town has market days and annual fairs, and is allowed to produce and sell alcohol, it is a shtetl. Why so? Because 99% of those people who will be in trade and in tavern keeping will be Jews. So the shtetl is not, I would say, I will rephrase my answer. It's not the statistics and demography understood directly what makes the shtetl into a shtetl. It's what Jews do in town. It's not the noun, it's a verb, excuse me for these terms.
Go ahead, please. The question is about Bessarabia. I left Bessarabia out. Well, I also left Belarus out, and I left Lithuania out. You know, you can do only so much. I'm trying to take what I control best, and I'm trying to say, yes, it is representative. If you disagree with me, come to argue with me in private. I do think that Bessarabian shtetls are very close to the shtetls in Ukraine. In Ukraine, you also have local nobility there. You have magnates, less Poles, but more Eastern Orthodox. You have many Eastern Orthodox magnates who are also owning towns in these particular areas. You have Jews overrepresented not only in trade and commodities, but also in trade in agricultural products. Jews are very much overrepresented in wine production in Bessarabia. Bessarabia provides enormous amount of wines for the entire Southern Europe. I also think that economically, the shtetls in Bessarabia and the shtetls in Ukraine are interconnected. You all the time see how, for example, merchants in cattle come from Bessarabia to this great shtetl of Balta, and which is the center for the cattle trade. And most cattle is brought by the Jewish merchants from Bessarabia to the town of Balta, which is on my three provinces, right, in the southwestern corner of it, right? So I do think that there is an affinity and economic and cultural links. But of course, if you think what are the shtetls that would remind you of the shtetls I'm describing beyond the territory that I'm describing, I would say Galicia to begin with. I see these connections all the time. And you see Jews from Berdichev taking wives from Brody, which is, you know, on different sides of the Russian of the Russian-Austrian border. And you do have many shtetlach in Galicia, especially in eastern Galicia, that are reminiscent of the patterns that I'm describing in the book. You know, would you allow me one more question? Yeah. Okay. Please go ahead. Mm-hmm. There is an excellent French historian whose name is Daniel Beauvoir. He wrote four volumes just answering this question. And he takes you from the partitions of Poland to 1830, then from 1830 to 1864, to different Polish rebellions, and then from 1864 to the beginning of the 20th century. Three volumes. The answer is the Russians were trying to kick out the Poles from the towns, because they realize if the Polish nobility controls the towns, it has certain and quite very high percent of the town income, and it can feed the Polish rebellion. They can buy horses, they can organize cavalry, and they are presenting an enormous threat to the integrity of the great mother Russia. So they were trying to apprehend these towns, transforming them from the authority of the Polish nobility, the authority of the Russian treasury. And this is a process that starts already in the 1770s and lasts through the 1860s. Just for you to understand, Berdichev is a shtetl. It has 45,000 people in the middle of the 19th century, but it is still a miastechko, that is to say, shtetl, or miastechko in Russian, miastechko in Polish. Why? Because it belongs to a Polish magnate, Radzivill. Right, and only in the 1860s, Russians finally managed to capture the town and get Radzivill out. So that is a process, my story unfolds with that particular process in the backdrop. Once the Poles are no more in control of the towns, they go back to Poland, which is again part of the Russian Empire, but they are now impoverished. They are not in charge of anything, and they do not have king to elect, and they cannot be the future kings. So this is a major decline of Polish nobility. What is amazing, and that's the story that I'm telling in the book, and I'll stop here,
what we considered before the attack of the Russian administration on the Jews was actually the attack of Russian administration on the Polish magnates. The Russian administration just realized you need to undermine the economy of the shtetl, of these private Polish towns, because if you do that, you undermine the might of the Poles. That was what they targeted. That was their target, not the Jews. Thank you.